Welcome to the second part of this introduction to MATLAB. So in the last video I have explained about the basic syntax of certain commands in MATLAB and how to create a vector in the MATLAB and how to create two-dimensional arrays. And then we have discussed some of the commands related to matrices. So in this video I am going to discuss about how you can get an output and input to the MATLAB, and also some of the conditional operators such as your if, for loop and while loop. And then I am going to discuss about figures, how to display a figure in your MATLAB, and how to create a custom function in your MATLAB. Finally, I will discuss about importing data into your MATLAB. Let's start with script file. It is nothing but if you want to run a collection of commands, it is impossible to do it in the command window. That too, if you want to debug some command and run multiple times, it is not possible to do it in the command window. So to run a set of commands, we need a file and we will run it as a whole. So for that we will use this script file, and we generally save this file with .yum extension. And based on the version of MATLAB you are using, you can create this script file by clicking on this icon, or you can choose file, new file, and then model you can do. In the latest version you can see there is a button here to add new script file. Okay, let's move to the MATLAB. So here you can see to create a script file, there is an option here to create a script file. It is a good practice to use these commands at the starting of your script file, so that it will clear all the previously stored variables as well as it will clear your command screen. So let's calculate the sum of two numbers. I have two variables, a is equal to 2, b is equal to 3. Now C will give me the addition of two numbers, and your D will give you the multiplication of your two numbers. So when you are running it for the first time, it will ask you to save your file, and please check or remember where to save your file. In my case, I am storing it in an desktop and tube folder. So I am saving it with the name ex1. Here you can see it is saved with an extension .yum. So you click the save, it will be run. I can go to the command window. Yeah, here you can see A is equal to 2, B is equal to 3, and C is equal to 5, and D is equal to 6. I have not used a semicolon commands. So if I put a semicolon for A equal to 2 and B equal to 3, the only these two results are will be shown in your command window. So in case of MATLAB, we will use percentage symbol to command particular line. So here I can write C gives the addition value and D gives your multiplication value. It is just for an explanation purpose. This line will not be executed when we are running this. So here I can run it. Now you can see at the output it only prints C is equal to 5 and D is equal to 6. So this is about script file and how to run it. Now let's talk about some of the matrices command. Now if I am interested in generating a random matrix say of order 1x6, then in MATLAB we use this command rand. So if I click on run, you can see it generated a random matrix of order 1x6. So in this matrix, if I want to extract certain values, or if I want to create another matrix which is a subset of this, I will be using a command colon for that. So here I am trying to pick the second element to, let us say, fourth element. Now you can see here my B is from 2 to 4. So this colon is used to indicate the starting value to the ending value. It will pick all the values and it stores in the value of B. Okay, this is what I have explained with an example. If you want to pick or address a certain range of elements, we will be using the colon. Next one is to refer to a particular column or refer to a particular row. If I want to access a particular row in a matrix, we will be using the command in this manner. This is your matrix name and colon comma n. It will bring out all the elements in the nth column. For example, if I say b is equal to a of colon comma 1, then all your elements in the first column will be stored in b. Similarly, I can access a particular row using this command. So let me go to a MATLAB. Now I want to again generate a random matrix. So A is equal to RANDOF. Okay, let me use small letters, RANDOF 5,5. So let me just run this and check the command window. So you can see we have got a matrix of order 5×5. If I want to generate a matrix with integer, then we will be using the command RANDI. There is a small change in the syntax. Here you have to mention what is the maximum value of the individual element I can have. So here you can see it will generate an random matrix of order 5×5 with a maximum value of 10. So let me run this. So you can see here it has generated a matrix of order 5×5 with the maximum value of 10. So now if I want to access the first row in this, so I am saying b is equal to a of first row I want, so 1, colon. This first element indicates the row and this element indicates your column. So 1, colon indicates all the elements in your first row it will pick and it will be stored in the b. Similarly, if I want to pick the first column, let us say a is equal to a of colon, 1. Now you will see that your first column will be picked and it will be stored in the C. So this is how we will generally pick a particular row or a column in your MATLAB. And there are some interesting commands or useful commands I can say when we are using with the matrices. So here the length of A, this command gives you the number of columns in your matrix. So let me go to my script file. In the script file, let me write it as len is equal to length of your A. So this will give you your number of columns in the matrix. Generally we will use, if it is an one dimensional array, we use the length. Otherwise, if you want to find out your or order of your matrix, we use the command size, which will give you your order from which you can be able to say the number of rows and number of columns. So the size command will give you order of the matrix. So let me run this. Now len will show you the number of columns. It should be 5 and your size, it should be 5,5. So you can see here, first it printed the matrix and then length as 5 and yes is it, you have 5,5. Or I can say the first element is 5, so yes is it of 1, first element indicates your row, and similarly yes is it of 2 indicates your column. So you can try remaining other commands such as transpose of A, determinant of A, inverse of A, all these things you can pause the video and try it on your own. So let me show you the determinant of A itself. So determinant of my matrix A, so it will calculate and it will give you the final answer. So I hope you guys have tried some of these commands. So similar to this, there are other commands. If you are having an one-dimensional array, then you can use these commands as well. Mean, it will give you average of all the elements, and max of A give you the maximum element and minimum of A give you the minimum in your array. And these things like sum of A will give you all sum of all the elements in the array, sort, median and standard deviation. So you can try these commands with your own example. Next, we will discuss about how we can get an input from the user in MATLAB. So here for this, we use the command input. So this is the syntax we generally use. Here it is a kind of help text. It has to be in within this quotation. So what I am trying to do here is that I am trying to get three inputs from the user, G1, G2, G3. And then I am trying to find the average of all the three values. So let me open the MATLAB and type all these commands. So here you can see that I have typed whatever I have shown in the presentation. So clc will clear my command windows. See, clear all will command all the variables. This is my command. I am trying to explain what I have done here. So here G1 is equal to input of enter the first subject mark, second subject mark, third subject mark, and I am trying to find out average of all the three. So let me run this. I have already saved my code with the file name ex1_input_data.m. So when I run it here in the command window, it will ask for enter the first subject mark. So let me enter 50. Once I press enter, it will ask for the next subject mark, 79, and let me try the third subject. So once I give the third input, it will print my output. AVG is equal to 57.33. If I want to run my program again, what I can do is I have to just type my file name, that is in this case ex1_input_data, and then press enter. So again, this is another way of running your file. So again, let me give some random values. So you will get this data. Next, we will see about how we can display an particular output to the user. So this is about input from the user. Now, if you want to show a particular output to the user, like some kind of text to the user, then we will use this command disp, which is nothing but displaying a particular text. So the command for this is DISP, and whatever the help text you want to show, you can give within a single quote or a double quote, both will work. And then whenever you are using a variable, don't use the quotation. So this is very simple. Let me show the demo in the MATLAB. Again, I am going to the same file. Okay, so here you can see I have added those two lines. Now let me run the program again. So you can see here the average mark score is 67. I did not use the semicolon in my previous one, that's why I am getting it here. So if I use a semicolon here, it will not be printed, and you can see the output only because of this. My output here, we are seeing 267. It is because here in this line I did not use the semicolon, and here also I displayed AVG again. So let me run it again. So some marks, random marks I am giving. Now you can see the average mark score is 67. So this is about your input and output. Next, we will discuss about relational operators, which we will use with our for loop, while loop and do while. So these are some of the commands. For equal to, we will be using double equal to sign, and for not equal to, we will be using tilt, equal, greater than, less than, and greater than or equal to, less than or equal to. So let's go to our conditional operators. So the first thing is the if, if else and else if. We will start with if, and there are no brackets, just the condition. And if the condition is true, it will execute the statements whatever we have given here, and then end command has to be there at the end. So the conditional expression evaluated to true or false. So based on the condition, whatever we are giving here, if it is true, it will execute, otherwise it will skip. So you know about if else. If it is true, it will execute the statement. If it is false, then it will execute the statement 2. And similarly for else if, If the condition is true, it will execute the statements 1. Else, if this condition is true, then it will execute this statement. Again, if this is not true, it will go here. It will check whether this condition is true. If it is true, it will execute this statement. The one difference is that from this, there won't be any bracket after the if keyword. It is just an expression. For example, it may be A greater than B or A is equal to 5, something like that. We don't use the parenthesis here for your conditional expression. So let me go to the MATLAB and show you the demo for this. Okay, here is an example for your if statement. What I am trying to do is I am trying to get an two input from the user, first number and second number, and using the if statement I am trying to display which is the greatest number. So here what I am checking is that if A is greater than B, display A, else display B. So this is just an simple coding to understand the syntax of if. There is no parenthesis after if, and here there is no indentation problem which you have in Python. So let me run this. So it will ask for first number 5, second number 10. So it will print the greatest number is 10. So this is an example for your if statement. This is what I have done there, trying to find out the greatest of two numbers. Next, we will discuss about for loop. So you know that the for loop is nothing but it will execute the group of statement for specified number of times. So the number of times will be specified using this index value. It generally has three values: it initial value, step value, and an end value. So your loop will be executed till it reaches an end value. So let me go to an example of something like multiplication of a number. So here what I am doing is I am taking an input from the user and I am trying to print every time what is the multiplication of that number from 1 to 10. So here you can see the syntax: for I is equal to 1 is to 10, your I value will start from 1 and it will increment at a rate of 1 till it goes to 10. This loop will be executed. So here you can see for I is equal to 1, it will go inside, let us say my A value is 2, then what it will print is, I did not use the semicolon here, so it will print K is equal to 2. So again it will go, my I value, it will increment by 1, this is my incremental value, increment by 1. So again it will come, it will print 2 into 2, 4. So it goes on till I value reaches 10. So the final printed value should be 2 into 10, it should be 20. So let me go to the MATLAB and show you this. Okay, this is for the for statement. Here I have done it from 1 to 5. So your for loop will be executed for 5 times. So let me run this. And you can see here it will ask for number. Let me print 2. So you can see here 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So this is about your for loop. Please pause the video and try out these commands. So next we will discuss about while loop. It keep on executing these statements as long as it satisfies your conditional expression. So let me go to the MATLAB and show you an example for this. So here is the while loop in practice. Again, I am using the taking the input from the user, and then I am initializing some value I is equal to 1, and then while I less than or equal to 5, these two commands will be executed. So here I am again printing the multiplication of a number, and here I am incrementing a value of I. So first it will come, I is equal to 1, so it will go inside, it will multiply with A, and then it will increment the value of your I. Again it will go back here, again it will check, my I is again less than 5 because initially it was 1, now it is 2. So it keeps on going till your I is less than or equal to 5. When it is equal to 5, still it will execute. When I value becomes 6, it will come out of the loop. So in this case, I should again get 5 values printed at the output. So let me run this. So let me type 2. So you can see here 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So this is about your for, while and if statements. So please pause the video and try out all these commands whatever I have shown, which will make you understand the syntax better. Next, we will discuss about figures in MATLAB. Like given a data, how you can present a plot. So the basic command for your 2D plots is plot of x, y, line space. Here line spec is used to define line style, line color and the symbol you are going to use to represent the points. So this plot function, it plots y versus x, and one important thing is the length of both x and y has to be same. So there are different options available for your line spec. You can specify whether it is a solid line, dashed line, dotted line, and what type of point you want, whether it has to be a circle, diamond, etc. And you can also specify the type of color you want to use it for your line. So the syntax will go like this. I have first time using CLC, clear all. I have an x vector and I have an y vector, and we will use the command figure. Even without the figure also it will work, but if we are having a multiple figures, it's good to specify this command figure before the plot so that it will open in the new window. So figure plot of x comma y. Okay, here is our plots file. Whatever I have shown here, I have copied it here. I have an x vector of length 5 and y vector of length 5, and I have used plot of x comma y. So let me run this. So you can see here an x is plotted against y. So at 1 comma 10 and 2 comma 20, and similarly 3 comma 30, 4 comma 40 and 5 comma 50. Now I will modify the line spec here. I am just making R here, which means that now it will change the color of the line to red color. Let me rerun this again. So you can see it here, your line color has been changed to red. Now if I want a dashed line, I can use these two dots. Now you can see there will be a dashed line. Now if you want, rather than line, if you want only the point, and each point has to be denoted as star, then you can see here now your line has been changed to star. Similarly, if I want to use a diamond symbol, I can use it here. So there are different line spec options available. You can refer to that slide and you can try your own design. So this is about 2D plots. In addition to that, in MATLAB we have options to have your logarithmic plot or your polar plot, or this we call it as a contour plot. And we can also plot your in the same graph, we can plot the multiple lines as well. In addition to that, we might be able to specify what is my x-axis, y-axis and legends and so on. So let me show you some of the examples of 3D plots as well. So here if you look at it, there are three axes. So these are our three dimensional plots. And then to specify your title, we will use these commands: title, x-label, y-label and legend, axis, grid on. So let me show you a demo for this as well. Now here I have two arrays. Let me add one more array as z is equal to 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. Now what I am trying to do is I am trying to plot x versus z. So in the same plot, in the same figure, I want x versus y as well as x versus z. So here this plot, it plots between x and y. Now I am going to plot x versus z. Let me plot as diamond red color. So this command will plot between x and z. Now I want to show both the plots in the same figure. So here we need to use a command called hold on, which will make this plot also will come in the same figure. So this hold on has to be used to hold on to this plot as well as this plot. So let me run this. So if you want to have a multiple plots in the same figure, you have to use this hold on command. So let me change the design. One is your dotted line and another one is your this one. So this is about how we can plot multiple plots in the same figure. Okay, now if I want to comment multiple lines in the coding, it is practically impossible to keep on adding a percentage symbol to multiple lines. So for that, what we can do is you can select all the lines whichever you want to comment and press Ctrl R. So Ctrl R will make whatever the selection you made, it will comment all the lines. Now if you want to remove this commented line, again select whichever line you want to uncomment and then press Ctrl T. So this is about commenting and uncommenting multiple lines. This is the code where we are trying to add your x label, y label and legend and title as well to your plot. So I have already explained about this hold on option. So let me show you this. So here you can see now I have added title, x label, y label and legend. So now let me run this code. So now you should be in a position to see x axis, in y label I have given y comma z axis, so that is coming. And then you can see title as test plot and it indicates this dotted line is between your x versus y and your red line is between x versus z. So this is an example for an two dimensional plot. Now let me show you an example for your three dimensional plot. Here for three dimensional plot we use plot 3 command. So now if I run this, you can see you will have a three dimensional figure. One is your x axis, another one is your this is your z axis, sorry, this is your x axis, this is your y axis and this is your z axis. Here also you can use all your line spec option. So I just want it as star and red color. Here in the three dimensional plot you can rotate your image as well. So here you can hold on to your right click button and if you move the cursor it will rotate so that you can able to see the points exactly where it is. And if you want to divide your image into multiple sections, then there is a command called subplot. So those who are interested can use help subplot in command window to know about the syntax, so that you can divide this whole figure into four and display four different images. So this is about different plots in your MATLAB. Next we will move on to custom functions in MATLAB. See, previously we have seen inbuilt functions such as square root, such as size of a matrix or a determinant of a matrix. Now I want to build my own custom function which performs certain actions. So in order to create such functions, there are two things we have to do. First, we need to create a custom function file. and then it has to be stored in the same folder as that of your main function. Here I am trying to create a custom function with name Hari, and it has two inputs A and B. So this function will perform certain mathematical operation and it gives one output F. So in creating a custom function, it is very important first you have to decide how many number of inputs as well as how many number of outputs. So here if I am going to use two inputs in my custom function file, I have to specify here two inputs. From this function, how many number of outputs I am going to get? So based on that, I have to specify the number of outputs here as well as here. Even though I have used the same variable a comma b and a comma b here, it need not be the same. This the number has to be same, but the variable here I can use different as that of this I have used in my main file. So this is the syntax I have to use in my function file. Again, the function file has to be saved with the same name as that of my function. So I have to create a function file and it has to start with this command function, and this is my output variable and this is my function name and these are my number of inputs, and it has to end with this end keyword. So this is going to be main file where I have a is equal to 5, b is equal to 3, and I am calling a function called Hari. So Hari of a comma b. So when we are running this particular file, what it does is it will execute this command, this command. When it comes here, it sees the function here Hari, so it will call this function file. So once it calls here, it takes these two variables into this file and it will execute this command and it will store it here and it will pass it to this F and it will come back here. So your result will be stored in Y. So Y is equal to 33. I hope the process is clear. Let's move on to the MATLAB. First, I will create a function file with these commands and store it in the name Hari.m, and then I will create an main file where A is equal to 5, B is equal to 3, and then I will run this. So no need to run this file separately. When I run the main file, it will automatically pick up this function from that file. So here is my function file. I have already copied the code here. It will start with the keyword function. This is my output F, which needs to be transferred to my main file whenever we are calling the function Hari. So this is my function name, these are the input. So the file should be saved with the same name as that of your function. So if you look at here, I have already saved this file with the same name Hari.m, and now I am going to create a main file where I am going to use this function Hari. Okay, this is going to be my main file. You know what about CLC, clear all. Here I have used a command close all. See what it does is it closes all the windows which are opened earlier. Here I am taking A is equal to 2, B is equal to 3, and in answer I am going to store the output of my custom function Hari A comma B. So when I run this, first it will your flow will be something like this: A is equal to 2, B is equal to 3, and then it will call the function and it performs the action. Whatever the output is coming, it will be stored in this answer. So let me run this and go to the command window. Here you can see first it printed A is equal to 2, B is equal to 3, F is equal to 9, and then answer is equal to 9. So if you look at your main function, A is equal to 2, it printed, B is equal to 2, it printed, and then it called a function Hari. In that Hari custom function file, it printed F from that, and then it printed answer from this main file. So that's how we got this. Now if I don't want this, I have to go to my custom function file. Here if I use a semicolon, then it will not print the F here. So let me use the semicolon. Whenever you have some unsaved editing here, you can see the star after your M here at the top. You can see there is a star, which means that your whatever the changes you made, it's not saved. So when you click the save here, you can find the change here. There is no star there, which means that whatever the changes we made, everything has been saved. Now let me go to my main file again. Let me run this. Now if you go to the command window and see, you will see A is equal to 2, B is equal to 3, and the answer is equal to 9. So this is about your custom function. You try to make your custom function in your own name with some expression and try to understand the syntax. Next we will discuss about how we can import the data into MATLAB from different files, such as your text file, your spreadsheet, or your mat files. So these are the three commands we most commonly use to import data into the MATLAB. Import data is generally used for text files and numerical data, and your read table command is used for importing data from your XLS or your CSV files. And if it is a mat file or dat file, we will use the load command. So the first one is import data command. So for example, let us consider I have a data something like this in your notepad, that is your txt file. So I have the file name called quiz data. So you can see here quiz data, and if you look at this file, your first row is something like text, and from the second row I am having the data, and also my each of the data has been separated by space, which we call it as a delimiter. Here my delimiter is space. Now if I want to use a import data function, your syntax is something like this: import data open bracket file name, here my file name is quiz data, and then what is the delimiter, and then header, how many header lines are there. So these three need to be specified whenever we are using import data. For file name, within quote I have to mention what is the file name here. It is quizdata.txt. And delimiter, what is the delimiter I have to use? In this file my delimiter is space. So the next one is header lines. So how many number of header lines are there? There is one header line here. So this is the basic syntax. Now all your data will be stored in your variable A. So whatever the first one has to be an file name, second one has to be delimiter, and third one has to specify number of header lines in your file. So let's go to the MATLAB for this. And one important thing is I have to save your quiz data, this file, in the same folder as that of the main file where I have this. Okay, this is going to be my main file. I have copied all the syntax whatever I have explained in the slide here. And one important thing is this quiz data.txt should be in the same folder as that of your my current file. Now if you look at my directory window, see this is my current file ex5_import data.m. In the same folder I am going to have the quiz data.txt file. So quiz data.txt file has to be in the same folder as that of your main file. Now when I run this, you can see in the command window. So now here you can see my variable A has a data file of 5x7. Let me open my quiz data.txt. If you see this quiz data.txt here, it has 5 rows and 7 columns. That's why it is showing your A is having 5x7. Now if I want to access my data from my A variable, I have to use this A.data. So whenever we are using import data command, in the variable it will be stored under data only. So in order to access this, I have to use this a.data. So you will get your data in this. I can assign it to any variable. So here you can see it has been assigned to the variable b. So this is about your import data command. And now let's move on to the next function where we can import data from XLS or CSV files. Even for TXT file this command will work. We have to use a command called read table and just a file name. Again here, to access the data you have to use a curly bracket. See, whenever we use a read table command, it will create a data type called table. So it is very similar to your dictionary in your Python. So in order to access the data from my table, I have to use your curly brackets. Same as previous one, you have to keep your XLS file or CSV file in the same folder as that of your current file. Now let's go to the MATLAB. So here is my main file. Again here, now I have taken my file name as quizdata.txt. again, it will work for XLS and CSV files as well. So the command is b is equal to read table of file name. So file name I have given here. So when I run this, now the data will be stored in your variable b. So I have run this. Now let's go to your command window. Now you can see here your b, it has a table of 5x7 table, and it automatically picks your headers. It automatically picks your headers from the file and data from your txt file. I did not mention anything. This is an advantage of your read table command. It will pick your header files and your data. Now if I want to access the first row in my table, I have to use the curly bracket. So 1, colon. So now if you see here, I am assigning the first row in my table to the variable c. So you have to use your curly bracket here. So this is how you can access your data from the table. So whenever we are using read table command, you have to use curly bracket to access your data. So moving on to the next one is the load command. See, load command we generally use for mat or dat file. Okay, let me also show you how we can save the data from MATLAB. So let me create my R is equal to rand of 1, 10. Now here what I have done is I have created 1x10 array. Now if you go to your workspace, you can see here R which holds all these values. Now here you go, right click it, and there is an option called save as. So you can save it. Again, I am desktop tutorial folder, I am saving it as in the same name as R. So here you can see the extension as .mat. So now if I go to my folder here, you can see here there is a file called R.mat. Now I can import this to any of my program. Even if I clear my workspace, this is going to be there permanently. So let me show you this. I can use clear all. So when I use clear all, there are all my variables has been cleared, and I have cleared my command window as well. Now if I want to import this to any of the program, let us say I want to import it here, I have to just mention load r.mat, and let me comment this, just display R. So now if I run this, it has to print the same array in my command window. So here you can see R, it has been printed 1x10. So this is how we export some of the data from MATLAB, because whenever we are running machine learning algorithm, generally we have huge data set and huge number of features. We tend to select and store it somewhere, and this is how we will save our data. Just right click and save, and it will be saved in .dat or .mat files, and we can import it using your load command. So with this we come to the end of our tutorial session, and if you have any doubt, please use the comment section to clarify your doubts, and thank you for watching.